Yeah, thank you very much. This is my name. This is the company I work at, but there will be nothing about that in this talk. I have another talk tomorrow with a colleague of mine sitting somewhere in the audience. If you're interested in what we do, then you can do that. So now, without further ado, let's go to code golfing. Or actually, with further ado, am I in here? It doesn't. One second. All right. I have to warn you that doing anything you see here at work might get you fired, and rightfully so. Right, so what is code golfing? Code golfing is the art of writing code that is technically correct, uses as few bytes as possible, so it's as short as possible. There's other languages where you measure it in, not in bytes, but in other units, but in Python you measure it in bytes. And there's no step three. So that's all. So that means no comments, no white space, no braces if you can get away with it. Only one-letter variable names in languages that allow it, like Python, usually leads to terrible code, to terrible complexity. Like you care about computability, not about complexity. That's what I mean with technically correct. All right, so now we're going to go through an example. I'm sure you all have seen this before. This is FizzBuzz, so the challenge of the typical whiteboard interview challenge. You go through the numbers from 1 to 100, and you print them, except if it's divisible, if the number is divisible by 3, then you're supposed to print fizz instead. If it's divisible by 5, you're supposed to print buzz instead. If it's divisible by both, so by 15, you print FizzBuzz. So far, so obvious. So this is a straightforward implementation. Notice the number on the bottom left. This is the amount of bytes. And we're going to try to take that down a bit. And I want you to think about what number do you think we can reach. So let's see. So another thing, I won't start with removing the white space. It would be probably the easiest thing. You could get rid of the indentation. But just for the sake of readability, I will defer that to a later point in time. Okay, all right. So we are right now at 182 bytes. The first step is we spend a lot of time using in the conditions in the first version. So Python has this neat exception thingy, which is really smart, and smart is good because it means we don't have to do it. Python does it for us. So instead of asking for checking these conditions, we have a list here, one letter variable name, where we store the result of the modulo of the number divided by 15, 3, and 5. And then we, so this will either contain some, it might contain a zero or it might not contain a zero. If it's not divisible by anything, it will not contain a zero. If it's divisible by, let's say, three, the second number will be a zero and the others won't be. And then what we do is we take this list, fizz, buzz, fizz, and buzz, and find the first element of the list where there is a zero. So that means the order matters here. If it's divisible by both 50, by both 3 and 5, then it will be all zeros. But since we look for the first element where this is true, we will find FizzBuzz and print FizzBuzz. And if there's no zero in the list, then we will fail. We'll throw a value error, I guess. And then we'll use a bare accept, terrible, great thing to do, of course. And then we'll print the number itself. So here, the order matters, as I said, yeah. I said one-letter variable names are great. That's true. But what's better than one-letter variable names is zero-letter variable names. So we can, instead of declaring the variable whenever you should try to put it directly in there, especially if you use it only once. So now we are at the previous one was 142 bytes, now at 132 bytes. Right, so what is shorter than exception handling? No exception handling. So what we can do is we can just put a zero, put the number there, the number itself in the list too, and put a zero in the list of potential zeros, so we will always find a zero. And in that case, we will get away with not having to do the exception handling, and now we're at 96 bytes. Now is the time for getting rid of the white space. So this is 84 bytes. Another thing, notice that this, there are no line breaks here anymore. The line breaks are just for wrapping, so you can see it better, and it fits in. It would be very small if it would all be in one line, but there's no actual line breaks here. So this is exactly the same thing as before, except we put it all in one line. This is a one line for loop, probably also not used that often in normal code. All right, we're not there yet, though. We can get this shorter. The next solution is not by me. I still like it. It is 62 bytes. So let's see what we're doing here. We're using two cool tricks here. The one thing is sequence multiplication, and the other is lazy evaluation of Boolean operators. So to the sequence multiplication first, you probably all know this, that you, if you take a sequence like a list or a string, and you can multiply it by an integer, and you'll just get the sequence, but that many times. So fizz times 3 is fizz, fizz, fizz. But importantly, fizz times 1 is fizz, and fizz times 0 is fizz, is the empty string. In Python, true and false are just 1 and 0, so you can also multiply strings by true or by false to get the string or an empty string. We also use this lower than 1 here. This is a bit weird. Why do we do lower than 1? Well, what we really want to do is to check whether the result of the modulo equals equals 0. And equals equals 0 is not really the same thing as checking for whether it's lower than 1, but always a good code thing practice. Even if it's wrong, if it technically works in this value range because we all have only non-negative integers, then use it. And so what we also do is now that we don't have to separately check for the 15 anymore because we just concatenate the strings. And the other thing, as I said, is that AND and OR evaluate to their last evaluated argument. So that means that OR, if the first argument of OR is truthy, then we will just return that. If it's not, then we'll just return the second thing, no matter what it is. So in this case, if we have fizzbuzz or fizzbuzz, we return that string. But if we have an empty string, because it's not divisible by any of these numbers, then we'll return I. Right. Does anybody think we can shorten this? We can, by 1 byte. yeah. So the first thing you might notice is that I cheated with the syntax highlighting here. Most of this is just one big string from the beginning of the print until the multiplication operator on the bottom there. So what do we do? We again use sequence multiplication. So we generate a long string times 100. So this string just times 100, and then we exec it after initializing I to 0. The rest is a bit complicated, but not so bad. So first of all, we now iterate over the numbers from 0 to 99 instead of the numbers from 1 to 100. So we'll have to account for that. We changed our condition again from the lowercase lower than 1 to something else, simply because now we can get rid of the parentheses and we save 1 byte per expression, so 2 bytes in total. So what do we do here? We do integer division. This is Python 3. I think you can also do it. It's sort of like Python 2's division, except it's always truncating the division. So let's say we are at the number 6, which is divisible by 3. Then I is actually 5. And 5 modulo 3 is 2. And 2 integer divided by 2 is 1. Any value that's not divisible by 3 will get a 1 or a 0. And 1 or 0 divided by 2 is 0 when you truncate. We do the same thing with buzz, except with 4 instead of 2, of course. In the end, we build sort of our own for loop with incrementing I there. And then there's this other expression there after the OR. Do you all know what the tilde operator does in Python? It's, the invert operator. It basically does a bit flip. It flips all bits. So algebraically, this does minus x minus 1, essentially. So minus x minus 1, minus that again. If you have 7, then minus 7 minus 1 is minus 7 is minus 8, and we negate that again as 8. So basically, minus tilde something is just that something plus 1. Why do we do that? Because then we can we don't have to use parentheses here, or we don't have to use spaces here after the OR, because this is unambiguous for the it's unambiguous for the Python grammar, so you can get away with just writing like that. Yeah. Okay. So this is the final solution that I found, or that actually this is also not written by me. I also found this on Stack Overflow, but if anybody will find a shorter solution, shorter than 61 bytes, please talk to me. I'm interested. All right. So you might be rightfully scared or disgusted now, but I still think that code golfing is good for you for several reasons. So first of all, puzzles are good. By restricting your vocabulary, in a sense, you become become more creative, and you will also improve your skill when you remove that restriction. So I would always compare this to poetry, where you also restrict your literary output to a certain format, depending on the kind of poetry you write, or the literary movement of Ulipo, where people write whole novels without the letter E. And similarly, I would say that then those people are pretty good authors. Understanding of this is good. So through code golfing, you get an understanding of things like the Python grammar, the lexer, the parser, operator precedence is very important. Yes, and finally, knowledge of this is also good. For me, this is sort of in the same category as meta classes, descriptors, the AST module, the inspect module. In that use of it is generally considered harmful, but knowing it still helps you. And there's maybe the one or the other some edge cases where it can actually help you. Well, I'm in time. So before I stop, I want to send you this to these sites. So I like this codegolf.segexchange.com. This is not just for code golfing, also for programming puzzles in general. There's codegolf.io. This is sort of like Vim Golf, if you know that, just for all languages. And of course, there's always a relevant XKCD. And you can find me on GitHub and Mastodon. Thank you for your attention. Good question. It is bytes. Yeah. Correct. This is, of course, you can do it however you want. It's based on convention, but even in Python 3, we can't usually do this in bytes, because otherwise there's pretty cheaty solutions. So this code golfing community is obviously not just Python, but all kinds of languages. Then there's people who write languages specifically for code golfing. And then you can pretty much fit anything in one letter, because you can use all of Unicode and have one letter that does FizzBuzz, one letter that does Hello World, one letter that does, and so on. So you count in bytes, but importantly, the final new line that you usually have doesn't count. So you can strip that off. Yes? I don't think the opposite works for programmers at all. How can you? Actually, I don't see so much Perl there, but yeah.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Going deep down into the hardware and the actual semantics of certain operations, the challenge is also that you have to work with those patterns two or three.
Yeah, of course. I mean, the solutions I showed was Python 3 only. I don't work with outdated Python versions, except at work. but I think you could actually get this one byte shorter in Python 2 because of print. But yeah, I try not to think about that.
Great. Okay. Let's take a great talk. Thank you.